Hello students, today we'll discuss about universal primary education, universal elementary education and non-formal education from the chapter adult education. It is a global movement led by UNESCO, aiming to meet the learning needs of all children, youth and adults by 2015. UNESCO has been mandated to lead the movement and coordinate the international efforts to reach education for all. Governments, development agencies, civil society, non-government organizations and the media are but some of the partners working toward reaching these goals. The EFA goals also contribute to the global pursuit of the 8th Millennium Development Goals or MDGs, especially MDG 2 on universal primary education and MDG 3 on gender equality in education by 2015. The Fast Track Initiative was set up to implement the EFA movement, aiming at accelerating progress towards quality universal primary education. UNESCO also produces the Annual Education for All Global Monitoring Report. In 2000, 10 years later, the international community met again at the World Education Forum in Dakar, Senegal, an event which drew 1,100 participants. The forum took stock of the fact that many countries were far from having reached the goals established at the World Conference on Education for All in 1990. The participants agreed on the Dakar Framework for Action, which reaffirmed their commitment to achieving education for all by the year 2015 and identified 6 key measurable education goals which aim to meet the learning needs of all children, youth and adults by 2015. In addition, the forum reaffirmed UNESCO's role as a lead organization with the overall responsibility of coordinating other agencies and organizations in the attempts to achieve these goals. The 6 goals established in the Dakar Framework for Action Education for All are: Goal 1, expand early childhood care and education. Goal 2, provide free and compulsory primary education for all. Goal 3, promote learning and life skills for young people and adults. Goal 4, increase adult literacy by 50%. Goal 5, achieve gender parity by 2005, gender equality by 2015. Goal 6, improve the quality of education. In order to evaluate each country's progress with regards to the EFA's goals set in the Dakar Framework for Action, UNESCO has developed the Education for All Development Index, or EDI. The EDI measures 4 of the 6 EFA goals selected on the basis of data availability. Each of the 4 goals is evaluated using a specific indicator, and each of those components is then assigned an equal weight in the overall index. The EDI value for a given country is thus the arithmetic mean of the 4 indicators. Since they are all expressed as percentages, the EDI value can vary from 0 to 100% or when expressed as a ratio from 0 to 1. The higher the EDI value, the closer the country is to achieving education for all as a whole. The components of EFA to achieve the goals are universal primary education, universal elementary education and non-formal education. It is a goal stated in many national development plans and pursued with vigor by governments of most developing countries. Primary education is seen as a first step in laying the foundation for future educational opportunities and lifelong skills. It is given importance to ensure that by 2015, children everywhere, boys and girls alike, will be able to complete a full course of primary schooling. Education is vital to meeting all other Millennium Development Goals. Educating children gives the next generation the tools to fight poverty and prevent disease, including malaria and AIDS. The objectives of primary education are literacy. The child should learn the first language, the mother tongue, to a level where he can communicate his ideas easily. Numeracy. The child should develop ability in four fundamental numerical operations and to be able to apply these to solve problems in his daily life. Technocracy. The child should learn the method of inquiry in science and should begin to appreciate science and technology. Nationalism. The child should develop a respect for national symbols like the flag and the anthem and should know about dislike to casteism, untouchability and communalism. Human dignity. The child should develop healthy attitudes towards human labor and dignity. Sanitary habits. The child should develop habits of cleanliness and healthful living and an understanding of the proper sanitation and hygiene of the neighborhood. Aesthetic sense. The child should acquire a taste for the good and beautiful and should take care of its surroundings. Cooperative spirit. The child should learn to cooperate with others and appreciate the usefulness of working together for the common good. Besides these objectives, other desirable qualities are development of character and personality through initiative, leadership, kindness, honesty, etc. These should be developed during the primary school stage. The National Policy on Education has also given stress on primary education mainly on two aspects, universal enrollment and universal retention of children up to 14 years of age, a substantial improvement in the quality of education. It is laid down that primary education cannot be accepted as complete unless children acquire minimum level of learning. Since 1999, there has been great progress towards achieving universal primary enrollment due in large part to a pursuit of the Millennium Development Goals and the Education for All. The number of primary school age out of school children dropped by 42% between 2000 and 2012 despite rapid population growth. Greater than half of countries and regions worldwide have a net enrollment rate of more than 95% and either already have or are close to achieving universal primary education. However, despite an increase in enrollment over the past decade, global progress has stalled since 2007 and net enrollment or attendance is less than 80% in about 20 countries. Of the 58 million children out of school, 23% attended school in the past but left. 43% are likely to never enter school. 34% are likely to enter school in the future. Roughly half of all out of school children come from just a few countries, many of them characterized by conflict, instability, and extreme poverty. Challenges to achieving universal primary education are aggravated in unstable regions as they have greater difficulty in accessing financial support. The barriers which prevent children around the world from obtaining primary level education are diverse and require tailored responses. Children are living in conflict affected areas account for just 20% of the world's children of primary school age, but 50% of the world's out-of-school children. Additionally, inequalities in wealth significantly impact out-of-school rates. In many countries, children from the poorest 20% of the population are less likely to attend school than those who are better off. Despite overall improvements, girls continue to be at a disadvantage as 53%, more than half of the estimated 58 million primary age out of school children are girls. It is a program conceptualized and evolved on the basis of varied experiences the country possesses and supplemented by the experiences of various international agencies directly involved in the funding of primary education projects in the developing countries. This is a centrally sponsored scheme launched in 1994 as a major initiative to revitalize the primary education system and to achieve the objective of universalization of primary education. Over a period of time, the sources of funding got diversified and the approaches to planned primary education and to the DPEP became more specific, concrete and unified. It is envisaged as a centrally sponsored scheme with flexible parameters. These parameters are meant to ensure that the plan is within the framework of national concerns and priorities. To provide access to all children to primary education through formal primary schools or its equivalent through alternatives. To reduce overall dropouts at the primary level less than 10%. To increase achievement levels by 25 percentage points over and above the measured baseline levels. To reduce disparities of all types to less than 5%. DPEP made a serious effort to translate the idea of decentralization into an operational practice through various steps. They are: the program identified district as the unit for initiating decentralized educational planning. Selection of the unit for planning, namely a district, is in line with the understanding that India had arrived at as per the recommendations of various committees. The program attempted to alter the pattern of resource decisions from state level to local levels. The program attempted to strengthen the planning process to make it more consultative, participatory and transparent. It tried to provide professional resource support to academic activities through new organizational arrangements like the BRCs and CRCs. It attempted to provide support to schools through providing contingency grants of Rs 2000 to each school and Rs 500 to every teacher annually. The planning process tried to create local level capacity both at the district and sub-district levels. Sarah Shipshape Hinayana is a programmer for Universal Elementary Education. This program is also an attempt to provide an opportunity for improving human capabilities to all children through provision of community-owned quality education in a mission mode. It is a response to the demand for quality basic education all over the country. The main features are: program with a clear time frame for universal elementary education, a response to the demand for quality basic education all over the country, an opportunity for promoting social justice through basic education, an expression of political will for universal elementary education across the country, a partnership between the central, state and the local government, an opportunity for states to develop their own vision of elementary education, an effort at effectively involving the Panchayati Raj institutions, school management committees, village and urban slum level education committees, parents-teachers associations, mother-teacher associations, tribal autonomous councils and other grassroots level structures in the management of elementary schools. Aims: to provide useful and elementary education for all children in the 6 to 14 age group. To bridge social, regional and gender gaps with the active participation of community in the management of schools. To allow children to learn about and master their natural environment in order to develop their potential both spiritually and materially. To inculcate value-based learning, this allows children an opportunity to work for each other's well-being rather than to permit mere selfish pursuits. To realize the importance of early childhood care and education and looks at the 0 to 14 age as a continuum. Objectives: all children in School Education Guarantee Center, alternate school, back to school camp by 2003. All children complete 5 years of primary schooling by 2007. All children complete of elementary schooling by 2010. Focus on elementary education of satisfactory quality with emphasis on education for life. Bridge all gender and social category gaps at primary stage by 2007 and at elementary education level by 2010. Bade Bharat, Bade Bharat. This is a nationwide sub-program of Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan. Children who fail to read in early education lag behind in other subjects. The program is designed to improve comprehensive early reading, writing and early mathematics program for children in classes 1 and 2. The program will not only provide print-rich environment, timely distribution of books, but also include new teacher mentoring and appraisal system. Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, SSA, has been operational since 2000-2001 to provide for a variety of interventions for universal access and retention, bridging of gender and social category gaps in elementary education, and improving the quality of learning. SSA interventions include inter alia, opening of new schools and alternate schooling facilities, construction of schools and additional classrooms, toilets and drinking water, provisioning for teachers' regular teacher in service training and academic resource support, free textbooks and uniforms, and support for improving learning achievement levels and outcomes. With the passage of the RTE Act, changes have been incorporated into the SSA approach, strategies and norms. New innovations and alternative strategies. Disaggregated target setting and decentralized micro-planning, which will provide the framework of universal access and community participation. Strengthening alternative channels of schooling, such as the non-formal education system, NFE, for those who cannot avail of conventional full-time schooling. Introduction of minimum levels of learning, or MLLs, at primary and upper primary stages to improve learners' achievement. Improvement of school facilities by revamping the scheme of Operation Blackboard, or OB, and connecting it to the MLL strategy. Establishing linkages between programs of early childhood care and education, ECCE, Primary Education Literacy and UEE. Addressing the more difficult aspects of access, particularly to girls, disadvantaged groups and out-of-school children. Restructuring of teacher training in view of the changed strategies and programs. Availing of external financial support for basic education. Launching the National Elementary Education Mission, NEEM. Non-formal education is the educational activity organized outside the formal system of education. It is simple and flexible and can be delivered at any place convenient to the learners. It is generally designed to meet the basic learning needs of disadvantaged groups and can be availed of at any age. Children out of schools, working children, and girls who cannot attend school for the whole day can join this program. Characteristics of non-formal education. Non-formal education is not only for children but for adult men and women. It is for rich as well as for poor, as it adopts a democratic approach wherein each and every citizen has a right to participate. It has no fixed curriculum, working days or working hours. Example, in formal education there is a fixed curriculum, duration and evaluation system. Whereas in NFE, there is no fixed format for admission, evaluation, or even a fixed curriculum to follow. It is flexible and adapts itself to suit the needs and skills of learners' abilities. Example, if the learner has interest in agriculture, then the learner is provided non-formal education related to agriculture. It is employment-oriented and work-based. Example is, NFE gives education which prepares its learners for skill-based jobs. A maid servant gets training of a home governess through NFE then it will give her good job and salary. Movement from work to learning and learning to work is possible. Example, a farmer wants to learn new skills and techniques of farming. By joining NFV classes, both learning and work can take place simultaneously. It is not expensive and therefore everyone can afford it. Objectives of non-formal education: to motivate the dropouts or such children who have not gone to primary school and enter them into the fold of non-formal education. To develop in children various linguistic skills and enable them to listen, speak, read and write properly. To make children understand and appreciate the scientific phenomena in everyday life. To develop in children skills, habits, attitudes necessary for healthy living. To make children understand and appreciate culture, heritage and tradition of the country. To develop in children functional numeracy. To develop in children a sense of citizenship, national integration, secularism, socialism, etc. To bring about awareness among NFE learners with regard to current issues and problems of the country and develop competency in solving the same. Need for non-formal education in India. The NFE, which is flexible and relevant to the lives of illiterates and the poor, needs to be encouraged in our country on account. To universalize elementary education by providing facility of elementary schooling in all habitations. To cope with limited resources by means of non-formal mode of education with part-time teacher and reduced duration of schooling can solve the problem to some extent. To serve the scattered and scarcely populated areas with comparatively less amount of expenditure. To meet the inadequacies of formal education by including vocational training in life activities. To enable the pupils to learn while they earn by engaging them in some job or occupation they like to learn while they earn. To meet the needs of late bloomers through non-formal modes. To provide education to economically deprived classes of the society to improve their vocational competence and quality of life. Any questions?
Hello ma'am, this is Alekya. I have a question. What is the difference between formal and non-formal education?
Interesting. Formal education is classroom-based, provided by trained teachers, whereas informal education happens outside the classroom. In after-school programs, community-based organizations, museums, libraries, or at home. Any further questions? This brings us to the end of this lesson. Thank you.